Sri Ganesha, please be kind and merciful and forgiving that you manifest within ourselves. Let all these hypocritical things, all these conditionings and all these wrong ideas we have, or all the wrong life we have had, should just disappear like thin air, and let the beautiful moonlight of your soothing qualities of innocence be manifested through us. Sri Ganesha, please be kind and merciful and forgiving that you manifest within ourselves. Let all these hypocritical things, all these conditionings and all these wrong ideas we have, or all the wrong life we have had, should just disappear like thin air, and let the beautiful moonlight of your soothing qualities of innocence be manifested through us. Sri Ganesha, please be kind and merciful and forgiving that you manifest within ourselves. Let all these hypocritical things, all these conditionings and all these wrong ideas we have, or all the wrong life we have had, should just disappear like thin air, and let the beautiful moonlight of your soothing qualities of innocence be manifested through us.
Third Pitha, Agnya Chakra. Eight spokes representing the eight Vasus, the deities who protect the eight directions and the eightfold form of Sri Shiva, Sri Ashtara. Om Tvami Sakshat Shri Ashtara Namo Namaha. The remover of all diseases, Shri Sarva Roga Hara. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Sarva Roga Hara Namo Namaha. The goddess who knows the deep secrets of all the siddhis, Shri Tripura Siddha Ati Rahasya. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Tripura Siddha Ati Rahasya Namo Namaha. Power which attracts, Shri Vashini. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Vashini Namo Namaha. Power which excites, Shri Kameshwari. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Kameshwari Namo Namaha. Power which makes you happy, Shri Modini. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Modini Namo Namaha. Power which makes you clean, Shri Vimala. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Vimala Namo Namaha. Power which gives you color in the face, Shri Aruna. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Aruna Namo Namaha. Power which gives you the feeling of victory, Shri Jayini. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Jayini Namo Namaha. Power which connects you to everyone, Shri Sarveshi. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Sarveshi Namo Namaha. Power which gives boons, Shri Kaulini. Om Tvameva Sakshat Shri Kaulini Namo Namaha. Sakshat Shri Adi Shakti Mataji Shri Nirmala Devi Namo Namaha.
Buddham Saranam Gacchami, Dhammam Saranam Gacchami, Sangham Saranam Gacchami. Shrima Saranam Gacchami. Shrima Saranam Gacchami. Ghabraye जब मन अनमो, हृदय हो उठे डावाडो, घबराए जब मन अनमोल और हृदय हो डावाडोल, तब मानो तू मुख से बोल जब दुनिया से प्यार उठे, नफरत की दीवार उठे, माँ की ममता पर जिस दिन बेटे की तलवार उठे, धरती की काया कांपे, अंबर जगमग उठे, बोल तब मानो तू मुख से बोल, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, तब मानो तू मुख से बोल, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि, संघं शरणं गच्छामि, श्रीमा शरणं गच्छामि, श्रीमा शरणं गच्छामि। दूर किया जिसने जन मन के व्याकुल मन का अंधियारा, जिसकी एक किरण को छूकर चमक उठाए जग सारा, दीप सत्य का सदा जले, दया अहिंसा सदा चले, सुख शांति की छाया में जन मन गन का पेड़ पले, भारत में भगवान बुद्ध का गूंजे घर घर मंत्र अमोल, तब मानो तू मुख से बोल, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, तब मानो तू मुख से बोल, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि, धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि, संघं शरणं गच्छामि, श्रीमा शरणं गच्छामि।
So today we have gathered here to worship Buddha. Lord Buddha, as you know, was Gautama, the one who was born in a royal family. And then he became an ascetic because he was very much hurt to see three types of problems from which human beings suffer. And he came to conclusion all these three types of problems are because we have desires. So he said that if you become desireless, then there will be no problem for you. So he studied Vedas, he studied Upanishads, he studied all kinds of things, he went to many saints and many people. He could not get his realization. Actually, he was an incarnation. The incarnation also has to reach a point of realization in a different way. Like, the whole potential has to open out. But the incarnation has tremendous potential. And that expresses itself once the door is open outward. Buddha realized the greatest problem of human beings is his ego. In his ego, he goes to the extremes, from one end to another. And so he worked throughout on the Pingala Nadi for us and stationed himself on our ego to control it. If you see on the Agya Chakra, if in the center is Christ, we have on the left Buddha and on the right is Mahavira. All of them are called as lords because they are rulers of these three areas. Now this area of Agya is the area of tapas, is of penance. Because they have done penance for us, we don't have to do any penance. They have done for us everything that is possible. That's how the Sahajogis don't have to do any penance. They are in a beautiful place, having a nice vibrations. They don't have to go in the jungles, run away from the society and hide themselves in a place where there could be scorpions, could be snakes, could be tigers, could be any danger to life. So the penance part is over, and also Buddha in his lifetime, when he was alive, all the time he said there is no need to have any austerities. There's no need to have any austerities at all. If you read Buddha's early teachings, then you'll be surprised that he said there should be no austerities. He himself went through austerities. But that was the time, Samayachar was time, where they needed people who would go all out to do the propagation of his ideas. So most of them took to a kind of a life, but he never believed in any austerities. Moreover, he was not a vegetarian. He died because once he went to a village and he was hungry, and he asked one of the hunters, we call them as kiratas, that I would like to eat now and I have to go for my work. He said that this morning I have killed a wild boar, but it must take some time, otherwise it's very hot blood. He said, doesn't matter. Very significant, right side, to take the red meat of a wild boar without getting it cooled down. He ate it and he died with that. Everything that they do has a meaning. As we find meaning in the life of Christ, we find in the meaning of Buddha also. That is the reason why the Buddhists became vegetarians. Because Buddha died eating that hot meat, they became vegetarians. But that doesn't mean that everybody has to become vegetarian. Those who have ego, it's better they are vegetarians. Right side people are better with the vegetarian food, more, and the left side more with the protein, that we know very well. So he tried to control the people who were with him in a way which was very loving and affectionate. But what was the accent in his message is to be understood. There was one boy who came to him and asked him that, sir, will you initiate me into Buddhism? It was not ism that time. Will you initiate me? He said, my child, only the Brahmins can be initiated, meaning the realized souls. What is your birth? He said, sir, I don't know my birth. So went back to his mother and asked, what is my birth, mother? Who was my father? She said, my child, I was a very poor woman and I didn't know how to exist. So I had many lords, I lived, and I don't know who is your father. You don't know you my father? He said, no. So he went to Buddha, and Lord asked him, now who is your father? What is your caste? He said, sir, I have no caste, because my mother told me that she had many lords and she doesn't know from where I am born, so I don't know my father. So Buddha embraced him. He said, you are the Brahmin because you have told the truth. So the essence of his life is truth. First, we have to be honest to ourselves. And I find some people find it very difficult to be honest to themselves. They know how to escape the truth. They know how to manage to get out of it. They'll give some argument, or they'll give some explanations. Whom are you giving explanation to? Yourself only. Your spirit is residing within you, which is enlightened. in your attention. And now, whom are you explaining? To your own spirit? So the message of Christ may be that we have to resurrect ourselves. But what about resurrection? That you have to be very honest to yourself, first thing. First and foremost thing to know that your caste is a Brahmin. That you know the Brahma, you know the all-pervading power, you have felt it. You are the real Brahmins. And as real Brahmins, you have to be Spartan. I mean, in India, say we have a Brahmin. They may not be real Brahmins, but born in a Brahmin family. There may have been forefathers, might have been Brahmins or something like that. They call themselves Brahmins, all right. So what is their speciality? At 4 o'clock in the morning, they'll get up. All the Brahmins. That's how you can make out a Brahmin. I am also a Brahmin that way. Then they'll have their bath, clean themselves completely and sit down for prayers or pujas or maybe meditation. That's how you make out a Brahmin. Though they are not Brahmins, but the tradition. While say a Shudra in India, he'll get up at 9 o'clock. In tradition. Wear dirty clothes, put his hands in his mouth, will be a lousy fellow, surrounded by rubbish. He cannot even feel the smell of the filth. Because they have been doing that kind of work. Traditionally, they are not. There are many Brahmins we have found out now who are really born in a Shudra's families. So actually in the Shudra's families as such, it's not by birth, but by their aptitude, by their jati, they are Brahmins. But traditionally, it's accepted in their society. Their hair will be disheveled. You can immediately make out. No oil in the hair. First point. No oil in the hair. Hair are all disheveled. Secondly, they are not bothered about sex life. And amounting to the Rakshasas, it's only the Rakshasas who get interested in women, look at women and all that. Actually, according to Puranas, I'm sorry to say, is a quality of Rakshasas. Because when there was the churning, the manthana took place. And Amruta came out of, Ambrosia came out of the sea. Then Sri Vishnu knew the weakness of the Rakshasas. They had taken the kumbha, the pitcher of the ambrosia by force, the Rakshasas, because they were more powerful, more egotistical, they could cunning. So they managed with the devas and took away. And they were about to drink it. So Sri Vishnu knew the weakness of Rakshasas. So he dressed up like a lady, Mohini, called himself Mohini. Mohini means the one which attracts you by your dress, figure, all this kind of nonsense. And immediately all the Rakshasas fell for her, for him I mean. Immediately, I mean, you could make out between the Devas and the Rakshasas. But, say, in Greece, they have made Devas into Rakshasas. Solved the problem. And as soon as he discovered that one of them had taken something, it said so in mythology, he went and giggled. And being a Rakshasa, I liked a lady giggling, giggled at him and then tried to tickle. Rakshasa, very proud, a beautiful woman coming and tickling me. Oh. As stupid as he was, he felt so tickled that he vomited out. And they say that garlic was born out of that ambrosia. Said so, I mean, mythologically. So when I see people in Sahaja Yoga not being honest to themselves, the first thing they must know, ego, is a very, very cunning stuff. But also it makes you a slave of another ego. See now, for example, a lady would go to these beauty shops, dress up herself, wear these, do all that, I don't know what they do, but they come out of it after 3-4 hours. And look the same to me. I don't know how much money they empty out. But it's something surprising that the hair is cut this time in a different way. So you ask, why did you cut it this way now? That's the fashion. That means you don't have your own ideas. You don't have your own concept. Whatever is the fashion, you just do it. You don't understand also that this is good for you or not. So the ego gets dominated, supposing there is an entrepreneur, say, very clever and cunning, more than anybody else, supposing. There are many like that, of course. Now he says that you can put a jam tin on your head and tie up your hair like this, and you look very fine. And he puts up lots of advertisement. All his jam tins can be sold. Without thinking they will use jam tins. Means you have no personality of your own. What's the ego? Ego should give you a personality, a character, a temperament. And when you see them, you can't make them out like sick people, you know. As you cannot make out one Sikh from another because they all wear beard and moustaches. You can't make out ladies from one to another because everybody has the same hairstyle, the same style of clothes, everything the same, because it's a fashion. Who has started the fashion? Some very cunning fellow wants to make money. In India we get a kind of a, call it tokni, is a kind of a basket, a small little basket. And suddenly disappeared from the market. We didn't know where it has gone. I mean, it's impossible. What can you do with it? It's a very simple thing. It was all in America. Why? The women are using them for their hair. I said, how? What do they do with their hair? No. See, nowadays they don't put any oil in their head. So they have all become bald. You will become bald, no doubt. If you don't put oil, I'm telling you now, you'll become bald. So we are austere people, we can't put oil, you know. But then we become bald automatically, you can join any Buddhist organization nicely, you don't have to shave. So they say that we have become bald now, so we have to have something. So they put those baskets, and on top of that they put what you call them wigs. Wonderful. But why? Why don't you put it on your head? No, you must have a nice fluffy hair, you see. For what? But that's the fashion. One day, one lady talking to me, her basket fell down and came down also, the wig. And that's how I discovered. So what is this is to understand that if you have your ego really in the real way, you should have your own personality, your character, your understanding, your speciality, your temperament. That's not there. What did Buddha do? He said, get rid of everything, your hair, even your eyelashes, anything that can be shaved off, hands, feet, everything shaved off. Imagine if you are following Buddhism, what would have happened to us? And he said, all right, just wear a kashaya, means a saffron clothes. Come with the saffron clothes, with everything shaved. And the ladies could wear only two dresses, one on the blouse and one a sari. That's all, no petticoats, nothing. Whether you are a queen or whether you are a sweepress, all of them should look alike, so no fashion anymore. But Buddhists are the greatest fashionable people you could ever think of. If you go to Japan, you'll go mad if you see their fashions. But they're so artificial. I don't know where is Buddhism gone, where Buddha always praised people who were natural. All Buddhism is lost like this, into a kind of a wilderness. Another thing, the right-sided people have a problem. Because if you become too right-sided, you neglect the left side, neglect your muladhara, because, you see, what's wrong? What's wrong? Till you get AIDS, nothing was wrong. Now, something is wrong. Till you get cancer, what's wrong in smoking? What's wrong? I mean, they advertise, even in India, that you look really great if you have a cigar in your hand or a cigarette in your hand. You look like a chimney, but all right. So they pamper your ego by telling you all these things, and you start doing it. And in that doing, you just forget that you are a stupid fool. We are going to lose all our beauty if we listen to these cunning people who are entrepreneurs. Take it from me. We had Mona Lisa. These days you don't find her anywhere. No. You have mosquitoes. Horrible. They think they are very beautiful. They don't emit any vibrations. From any angle of aesthetics, they are not beautiful. And by the time they are 40 years, they look at least 80. So, what has happened is that we are playing into the hands of our ego and our Muladhara is lost. Muladhara is the breaking point, break, is like a break. The right side is the accelerator and the left is the Muladhara, which is the break. What's wrong? That's why Buddha preached brahmachari, celibacy. Because if you go too much to the right side, now there are many complications. I can hear them for many people, that those who are overactive can't produce children. First, what's wrong? Then, complete dryness. They cannot have children. And if they have children by chance, may turn out to be rakshasas only. So too much asceticism can take you too much to the right. That's why Buddha said no asceticism is needed. He said it, though he had people around him whom he looked after, saw to it that they were celibate people, and he is the one who gave them balance and managed them. So once you start going on the right side, you end up automatically like a cabbage. Automatically. You cannot produce children. You cannot live long. Like taking cocaine, you can say. You speed up very much. You become very speedy. And you have to really, to live with them is so difficult, very difficult. Because they move with the speed of a jet and I move with the speed of an elephant. I just look at them going, coming, going, come. I don't know how to relate. So to curb this ego, we have to worship Buddha. We have to worship Buddha. But the first principle is to respect your chastity. Respect Buddha means to respect your chastity. You don't have to give up your wife as you have given, unless and until they are horrid. Don't have to give up your husband. All of them were without wives. Buddha had a wife, he gave her up. Mahavira had no wife, Christ was never married. But in Sahaja Yoga you do marry. You have children, no doubt. And as we were saying, that with ego we become in a way very much involved into ourselves. So we can say there are three types of people in this world. One, who are not bothered about others. So the first message of Buddha is honesty to yourself. And the first area where one has to see the honesty is in your chastity. You can marry, you can have a wife, you can have a husband, you can have children.
Ganesh Saksha Shri Adi Shakti Mata Shakti Mata.